वेरी गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, माई सेल्फ एक पांडे एंड वी आर अगेन हियर फ्रॉम नीट प्रेप फॉर यू. सो दिस इज द लाइव सेशन फॉर लॉस ऑफ मोशन फॉर इंग्लिश मीडियम स्टूडेंट्स. नीट इंग्लिश All the questions given in this paper were basically previous year problems. Every single question was chosen from the previous year papers. And as you can see, there were total 25 questions. So out of 100, Garima Sharma got 85, then Sachin Badal 79, then Jyotirmay Das 76. Well done guys and girls. Very good. 85. First rank, second rank, and third rank. So, let's start the discussion. If you have any problem or doubt during the discussion, you may comment. I can clearly see your comments. So, please raise the doubts if you have any during the discussion. Okay, so the question number one, which one of the following statements is correct? So you can clearly see, rolling friction is smaller than sliding friction. Sorry, we have to find the incorrect option. Rolling friction is smaller than sliding friction, this is correct. Limiting value of static friction is directly proportional to the normal reaction. This is also correct because friction force is mu times n. Coefficient of sliding friction has dimension of length. No. Coefficient is mu, which is dimensionless. So third option will be wrong. Fourth, friction force opposes the relative motion. This is also true. So for the first question, the wrong answer would be, which is our choice, C option. Let me see option. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, 11, 12, 14. Question number two. A block of mass M. A block of mass M is placed on a smooth inclined plane as theta as shown in figure. The wedge is given an acceleration. This triangular wedge is moving towards right with acceleration, some acceleration, which is what we have to find. We have to find the relation between acceleration of the wedge and the theta so that the block remains stationary with respect to wedge. What does this mean? It means a very simple thing. There is a wedge, a block is placed over this wedge. This wedge is moving forward with acceleration A. So we have to find this acceleration such that the block does not slide down. It remains at the same position with respect to wedge. You can clearly see. So the block should remain, block is stationary with respect to wedge. Okay. It means if we solve, if we draw a free body diagram, with respect to wedge, which is a non-inertial frame. Because it is accelerating. Then we have to add one more force called as pseudo force, apart from all the other forces like normal reaction and gravity. So with respect to wedge, if I solve, then all the forces which are acting on it are basically, this is the normal reaction, in this direction mg, let me just write, vertically downwards will be mg, and a pseudo force will be m into a. This is pseudo force which is equal to m into a. Now, because we are solving with respect to wedge and the block is stationary, it means all these forces must be equal to 0. F vector plus n vector plus mg vector will be equal to 0. So we can balance the forces along any direction. Suppose if I want to balance the forces in vertical direction, you can clearly see if this angle is theta, then this is also theta and this is also theta because this is 90 minus theta. So n cos theta will be equal to mg, component of n will be equated to mg, and similarly n sin theta will be equal to ma. From here you get cos theta upon sin theta will be equal to g by a. So from here you get a equal to g tan theta. Yes, Shivanshu, you are absolutely right. The block is stationary with respect to wedge. It means it is in equilibrium, but be careful, equilibrium in blocks frame, in wedges frame, not equilibrium in grounds frame, because in grounds frame it is moving with acceleration. So it is in equilibrium with respect to wedge, but it is not in equilibrium when we see from ground. So answer for 2 will be third, C option. Andy Kudal, you have a doubt, what is a vector and magnitude? Vector and magnitude basically is a way to represent physical quantity. Vector is a mathematical tool to represent those physical quantities which have direction and also add in a certain way. Some physical quantities similar to as we have seen here as force have direction, and when you add to force you get so many answers depending on the angle between them. So these type of quantities which have direction and they add in a certain way, which we generally call as law of vector addition, are vector quantities, and their values are their magnitudes. So vector and magnitude is a mathematical concept basically to represent physics variables, special variables of physics. Question number 3. Pseudo force. We have a doubt regarding pseudo force. Pseudo force is basically a force which we apply in free body diagram to all the blocks whenever we have to draw in some other frame which is accelerating. So as you have seen in previous problem, the block was stationary with respect to the wedge. So if somebody sits on the wedge and observes the block, he would find that block is stationary. But although if you draw the forces acting on them would be normal reaction and mg. So the Newton's second law gets violated. To make it valid, we add an extra force hypothetically, which is called as pseudo force. These videos are very well explained. These concepts are very well explained in the video. So please go through videos once. Very well explained about what is pseudo force and all. Weightages of this chapter, my dear, these are past almost, you would say, from 2014. These are past 5-year questions. And in some years we have seen two papers similar. I guess it was in 2015 and 16 there were two papers. So you would see that at least two questions per year. you may basically expect from this chapter. So question number 3 is done. No, question number 3 is what you have to do. One end of the string is connected to a particle mass m and the other end is connected to the small peg on a smooth horizontal surface. The particle moves in a circle with speed v, the net force on the particle. So what is net force? Net force is always mass into acceleration. And because particle is moving in a circle, horizontal circle, this acceleration is centripetal acceleration, which is v square by r. So the net force will be equal to m into v square by r. This is the net force which is towards the center. Towards the center. Okay. Now you would like to know which force is providing this centripetal force. So clearly string, because the string is causing it to move in a circle. So this is provided by string, which is tension. So the net force is nothing but tension in the string. So correct answer in this kit will be option A. Net force is mass into acceleration, acceleration v square by r, mv square by r is net force, and mv square is provided by which force? Tension. Similarly, when the earth revolves around the sun, then this is also a circular motion. The force, the centripetal force or the net force acting on the earth is mv square by r, which is provided by gravitational force. Furthermore, if I talk about electrons revolving around the atom, electrons revolving around the nucleus, they are also doing circular motion, they also have net forces mv square by r, but there the mv square by r is provided by electrostatic attraction. I think now it is clear to you. Question number 4. Suppose the charge of proton and electron differ slightly. Suppose, what does this mean? It means we generally take charge of proton as plus E and charge of electron as minus E. QE, QP. But what they are saying, suppose the charge of the proton and electron differ slightly. So let me assume it means the charge of proton is slightly greater than electron. Is slightly greater than electron. This is what they are saying us. If the net electrostatic force and gravitational force between two hydrogen atoms. So hydrogen atoms. Hydrogen has only one proton and one electron revolving around it. So generally as an atom, it is neutral. Why we take it as neutral? Because the charges are actually in reality they are equal and opposite. So net charge becomes zero. But here what they are saying is that there is some difference. Suppose if there is some difference, then the net charge will be equal to delta E. Similarly, another hydrogen atom, P and E minus, it also has net charge delta E. And also they have some mass. So due to mass, they will attract each other with the gravitational force. And due to this excess charge, they will also repel each other with electrostatic force. F electrostatic. So if I write the gravitational force Fg, which is G times M1, M2 by separation, let's say separation between these two is R. So R square, electrostatic force will be K, Q1 is also delta E, Q2 is also delta E upon R square. So this is the attractive force, this is the repulsive force. Why there is a repulsive force? Because they are not neutral. Why they are not neutral? Because the charge of proton and electron is differing slightly as given in the problem. Yes, Ayaz, you are absolutely right. Equate them. So from here they are saying is 0, then delta E in the order of, given the mass of hydrogen atom is this. So mass is given to us, just equate or you just divide. So you would see this will become 1 and 1, R square gets cancelled out and you get 1 will be equal to G by K M, both masses are same, so it will be just M square by delta E square. From here we get delta E as under root of G M square by K square. Now you don't have to calculate exact value, just put the orders. What is K square? It is 10 to the power 9 whole square. What is M square? It is given to us as 10 raised to the power minus 27 whole square. Similarly, what is, this is K is not a square, sorry, this is K simple, this is just 10 to the power 9. And what is G? It is 10 raised to the power minus 11. So just add all the orders and divide them by half, order means powers, you will get the delta E and it will comes around 10 raised to the power minus 38, I guess, in this order. We'll see the answer. Yes, 37. So the correct option in this case will be C option. You don't have to calculate exactly, you just have to put the orders or the powers of 10 and you will get the answer. Very good question. Question number 5. So a particle of mass m goes like this. It collides to the wall at angle 60 degree and then with speed v, then it gets reflected at the same angle 60 degree without changing, without any loss of speed. So we would like to know what is the momentum imparted. So impulse is change in momentum, final momentum minus initial momentum, which is mass time final velocity minus initial velocity. So if you take its magnitude, it becomes mass times under root of, we know final velocity is also v, initial is also v. So if I take the magnitude of this vector, it becomes v square plus v square minus 2 v1 v2, because both v1 and v2 are same, minus 2 v cos. Now be careful before putting this theta. This theta is the angle between v final and v initial. And you might think that this angle between these two velocities is 120 degree. Then I would say no, you are wrong. Because the angle between these two velocities is not 120. It is, theta is 60 degree. Okay, because here the head and tails are connected. So whenever there is head and tail, then we have to take 180 minus theta. So theta is 60. So when you put the values, you get impulse as I will be equal to m times under root of 2v square minus 2v square cos of 60. Cos 60 is half. So just let me put value of half. This half gets cancelled out. One of the v square will cancel this. So you get m into v. Simple question, directly done. Yes, you can do components also. Component is also good, not a problem. You can directly solve by doing the components. Mv cos theta, Mv cos theta, 2Mv cos theta. I just wanted to tell you some other way, because most of the students know this method. This is also one of the methods. So correct option will be A. Yes, Bandhan, there is one more way. By taking the components, if you see, if I take the components, this is 60 degree, this is 60 degree. So the component becomes V cos theta, and this component becomes V sin theta. Similarly, when it comes out, again you have two components. This component, now this time this angle is 60 degree. So V cos theta, V sin theta. So if you subtract final vector, final velocity minus initial, you will see these components gets cancelled out because they are in same direction. So only the change in vector is V cos theta, that is 2m V cos theta, which is your impulse. So just put the value of theta, which is 60, you get the answer 2m V. So this is component method, similar to that. Yes, yes. Do whatever you like, but do some practice. When you do few questions, after that you would see some formulas have some advantages in some type of problems, and so and so. You have to do a little bit more practice. Try to solve one question in 1 minute. One question in 1 minute. Okay. Question number 6. So this is Banking Road. So car is negotiating a curve of radius R. So basically, a car is moving in a circular path. This is the circular path in which a car is moving with some velocity of radius R. This is top view. But to increase the limit of the speed at which it can go, because if we increase the speed, there is a tendency that the friction force available is not sufficient enough to make it curve along this circle. Because the centripetal force V square by R, this is provided by friction force. Friction force provides the centripetal acceleration. To make it move in a circle, we need some external force, similar to the example of gravitation or the electron moving in an orbit, or in previous question you have seen the retention in the string. For any circular motion, you need some external force to make it curve towards the center. In this case, for the car, the external force is friction. But we know friction force is a limiting force. The maximum value of friction force is mu into n. N in this case would be mg. If the required velocity becomes greater than this friction force, if the required friction force becomes greater than this value, then of course the car will slid and it will not be able to complete the circle with this radius. Rather, it will go out of the circular track because friction force is not sufficient enough. So this should be greater than equal to mv square by r. So from here we get v should be less than equal to under root gr. So this is the limit on the velocity. But as we know, this is a very small velocity. So to increase this limit, what we do, we tilt the road by a slight some angle, which is called as banking. So it's a standard thing, you have done it in your videos. So we bank the road. Now I'm going to make a horizontal view. This was the top view. Now we will see the vehicle from the back side. So it will look like that you have tilted the road by angle theta, and this is your vehicle is moving in inward direction with velocity v, and this is the circle in which radius the vehicle is moving like this. We have tilted the road. These are the tires. Don't think that the vehicle is coming down. No. Vehicle is going like this. Vehicle is going in the plane of the, this is the back side of the truck. And these are the two back vehicle wheels. So if you draw the free body diagram, it has a tendency to slide downwards. So just draw all the forces. I'm already taking the component, I'm component of mg as well. Mg, this is normal. And of course, because it has a tendency to move out of the circular plane, friction force will act downwards. Okay, this angle is theta, this is also theta, and this is also theta. So in vertical direction, forces are balanced. So there are three forces, F, Mg, and N. In vertical direction, we have to see the, all the components. So in vertical direction, F has sin theta component, N has cos theta components, and Mg is downwards. So Mg plus F sin theta should be equal to N cos theta. Similarly, in horizontal direction, we have a centripetal acceleration. So centripetal acceleration is provided by normal reaction sin component as well as friction force cos component. So N sin theta plus F cos theta will be equal to mv square by r. These are the two equations. Further, to get the limit, we will put the friction force is equal to mu times N, not mg, because normal reaction will be not equal to mg here. So this is third equation. So I am rewriting these equations so that it becomes easy to solve. Keep friction force and normal on one side. So you get mg as n cos theta minus f sin theta, and mv square by r as n sin theta minus f cos theta. Now put the value of friction as mu n so that you can take out the n. From here I am putting the value of f as mu n. So mu n. So as you put mu n here, it becomes v max, maximum velocity. Now just divide. So you will see this n and this n can be taken out and will be cancelled from this n and this n. So similarly here, m gets cancelled out. So you get rg upon v square as cos theta minus mu sin theta upon sin theta minus mu. Sorry, I think it is correct or not. Here we have plus mu cos theta. So by rearranging it, you get v equal to under root of gr into sin theta plus mu cos theta upon cos theta minus mu sin theta. So this is the derivation. And I think this is little bit important one, because this question was directly asked, this expression, in your exam. So they may ask value by giving some values next time instead of this direct expression. But the option is given in 10 theta, so you have to rearrange it, take out the cos theta common from here. If you take out the cos theta common from here, it becomes sin theta upon cos theta. Similarly, if you take out the cos theta common here, it becomes 1 minus mu sin theta of cos theta. This sin upon cos becomes 10 theta, this also becomes 10 theta. So the expression becomes 10 theta plus mu upon 1 minus mu tan theta. Okay, just rearrangement of expression. Correct answer will be 3. Yes, yeah, absolutely right. Yeah, if you can remember this, that is well and good. But you can remember only if you derive it by yourself once. Otherwise, there are so many, you know, confusing terms. Let's go to the next question. Question number 7. Khushi, you have the video. It would be waste of time for others if I repeat the same thing again. Please go through the video after the live session is finished. This video is available to you forever. So just rewind the video, you can see the same thing again. If you have any specific doubt, then I would tell. I confuse in the normal direction in the complex problem. Okay, normal reaction is only, it is the pushing force, and always along the normal of the surface. So always remember, it is pushing in nature and it is normal to the surfaces in contact. Suppose if you have, for example, suppose if I want to find the normal reaction acting on this body, then it has been in contact at these two places. So it is a pushing force. This block will be pushed by these two corners. Pushing, it means away. So this block will be pushed by this corner in which direction? Normal to the surface. So this is surface, draw the normal. So it becomes normal reaction 1. Similarly here, remember normal to surface. Pushing force, that's why upwards. Similarly, this corner also will apply the force pushing and normal to the surface. This is the contacting surface. And draw a line normal to it at the point of contact. This will represent N2. Normal. And just apply laws of motion, I think. Khushi, if you can remember the formula, then in exam, they may give you some angles, theta, and they may ask what is the range of velocity in which the body can safely move in a circular path of radius r. So just you have to put the values of theta and so on. This is a standard question of banking of roads which you study in your NCRT as well. Sir, an object is in air, it means no any normal reaction is acting. Yes. If the object is in air, then the force acting on it will be mg and maybe dragging force. Unless you have a contact with a surface, you will not have any normal reaction. You need some contact somewhere. I think this will help you. Let's go to question number 7. Question number 7. This angle is given as theta. A block is kept on a plank and mg is acting downwards. Is gradually raised, the angle of inclination, the box starts slipping. So at theta equal to 30 degree, blocks starts slipping. We call this angle as angle of repose. So what they are saying, suppose if we have taken two surfaces, initially the surfaces were quite close to each other and the block is placed over here, and the second surface is taken upwards, it is rotated upwards, so after some time at certain angle, the block will start sliding. As you will make it vertical, at some point of time, the block will slide. At that angle, when the block starts sliding, is called as angle of repose. And we already know the friction force is actually equal to tan theta for that angle. And this is static friction force. Because friction force, as we tilt the surface, the mg sin theta component will increase and the normal reaction will decrease. So at some point, both will become equal. And that point is angle of repose. So static friction is directly tan theta, which is tan of 30 degree, which is 1 upon root 3. Okay. So 1 by root 3, you can write it as root 3 by 3. This is 1.73 by 3. So which is approximately 0.59 something. 0.6 would be more appropriate. Okay. So static friction force of coefficient is 0.6. And now we have to find the kinetic friction force. So at this angle, it takes 4 seconds to slide down from this point to this point. The distance traveled by it is given as 4 meter. It means 4 meter in 4 seconds. So when the body is sliding, kinetic friction force acts . So what is kinetic friction force? Kinetic friction force is mu k into n. So when the body was sliding down, the kinetic friction force was acting upwards and mg sin theta was acting downwards. So the net acceleration, net force will be mg sin theta minus mu mg cos theta upon m. So from here you get A equal to g common, take g common as, then sin theta minus mu cos theta. But remember, this mu is not mu s, this mu is mu k. So this is your first equation. Now if you calculate 4 meter in 4 second, initial speed is 0. So if you just apply the concept of s is equal to ut plus half a t square. Displacement is 4 meter, initial speed is 0 plus half a, time is taken as 4. So you would see that you get acceleration as 4 square 1 by 2 meter per second square. This is equation number 2. Just put the value of A over here. 1 by 2 will be equal to g times sin theta minus mu k cos theta. Now put the value of theta as sin theta. Theta is 30 degree. So sin theta will become half. Theta is 30 degree and cos theta will become, as you can see, that is 0.6, sorry, that was tan theta. Cos theta will be root 3 by 2. This is half, put the value of g as 10. So from here, solve and you will get the value of mu k. And of course, mu k will be always less than mu s. This is what we already know. So I am skipping the calculation part. The correct answer will be 3. If you carefully observe the options, my dear students, you even don't have to solve this part. Because if you know this concept that mu s is always less than mu k and you had already calculated mu s, you know the mu s. Now we have to find the mu k, which should be always less than mu s. So if you carefully observe all the options, there is only option C where mu s is greater than mu k. So you could have saved this time by just observing the options. So this is what they do. This had been asked in, I guess, 2015 or so. But I have told you both ways. Correct answer, this will be C option. Let's go to question number 8. Two stones of mass m and 2m are whirled in horizontal circles. The heavier one is in radius r2 and the lighter one is at radius r. The tangential speed of the latter stone is n times of the value of heavier stone when they experience the same centripetal forces. The value of n is, so we know centripetal force is mv square by r. So if I calculate the centripetal force for mass m f1, then it would be m, the heavier one would have radius r by 2, so m into the tangential speed of the lighter stone is n times nv of heavier times, where v is the speed of lighter heavier one, nv square by radius is r. Similarly for 2m mass, f2 will be equal to 2m times v square by r by 2. When they experience same centripetal forces, it means F1 is equal to F2. So if you equate these two, mv square n square by r as equal to 4 times mv square by r, you get n as 2. Option number B. Question number 9. You have a table. Three blocks are placed over it like this, A, B and C. 4 kg, 2 kg and 1 kg. 4, 2 and 1. Frictionless surface. A force is applied. Force of 14 Newton. Contacting force between A and B. So first of all, let's calculate the acceleration, because these all will move in acceleration. So A will be equal to net force upon total mass, because all of them will move together as a single mass. 4 plus 2, 6 plus 1, 7, 2 meter per second square. But we need to find the contacting force between A and B. The force between A and B. So for that, we have to break the system. We have to draw the free body diagram of this A block only. So we know A block will experience the contacting force by B in this direction. This is the contacting force between A and B. And we are applying 14 Newton force from here. And we already have calculated the acceleration as 2 meter per second square. So net force will be equal to mass into acceleration. The mass is 4 kg. So 14 minus n times AB will be equal to 4 times 2. So from here you get NAB as 6 Newton. Directly standard question. Yes, option number 3. Anuja, question number 8, F1 was, F2 was given, if you read carefully, they experience same centripetal forces. It is given in question. That's why we have equated. This is 4 kg block. This is 2 kg block. This is 1 kg. So all of them are in contact. So the 4 kg block, this is A, this is B, this is C. Because they are in contact, the 4 kg block will apply force to an perpendicular to the surface. And in response, this 2 kg will apply the equal and opposite force, which is normal reaction of AB. So one NAB acts on 2 and other NAB acts on 1. If we consider both as a system, then this become internal because 2 will cancel out. Okay. Similarly, these 1 and 2 will also apply force on each other. This is NBC, which is also equal and, equal and opposite NBC. So these are the normal reactions due to their contact because they will push each other. That's why. Yes, Santosh, you are absolutely right. This is Newton's third law of motion. Action-reaction pair of same type, equal in magnitude, different opposite in direction, and important thing, on two different bodies, A and B. Question number 10. A block of mass m rests on horizontal table. A string is connected to pass over a frictionless pulley at the edge of the table from the other side suspended. Question number 10. There is a table block of mass m. Block of mass m1. A light string is connected to it like this. This is block A and some other block B is connected to it. This is block B. This is M2. The coefficient of friction is given as mu k. When the block is sliding on the table, the tension in the string is. So it is given that the block A is sliding. Block A is sliding. It means this is heavier one. It is going down and due to which this block is sliding. So we can calculate the acceleration as if you you can directly apply the concept driving force upon total mass or just if you draw the free body diagram for this, you will see M2G downwards. Let's say acceleration is A and tension is upwards. So these are two forces. Downward force is greater because it is going downwards. So M2G minus T should be equal to M2A. Similarly for this thing, if we apply the same concept, we know the tension is causing it to move forward. But this, its motion is opposed by the friction force. Friction force is kinetic in nature, which is mu times n, mu k times n, which is mu k times, normal action will be equal to its weight here, because it is placed in a horizontal surface. So mu times m1g. Tension is moving, applied, is basically taking it forward. Friction force is opposing it, net acceleration is A. So if you apply the Newton's law in it, net force will be T minus mu m1g will be equal to m1a. Equation number 1, equation number 2. So if we divide these two equations, the A will cancel out and we get the expression in T. So T minus mu m1g will be m1a upon m2g minus T will be equal to m2a. So a gets cancelled out. So if you rearrange it, t minus mu m1g, this m2 gets multiplied here, will be equal to m2g minus t times m1. So if you see it carefully, you get the tension as mu times m1 m2g plus m1 m2g upon m1 plus m2, I think. Correct answer will be D option. Normal force is mainly static. Force is not static. Static is defined for bodies, not forces. Forces may cause a body to remain in a static position or to make it move. So it is wrong to say that a given force is static. There is no meaning of saying that this force is static, because force is nothing. Force is just an agent which causes a body to move, or it may cause the body to stop. So we generally talk about these terms as static equilibrium for body, not force. Question number 11. So you have three bodies. This is M1, M2, M3 on a rough horizontal surface. This is rough horizontal surface. All the masses are equal. M1 is equal to M2 is equal to M3 is equal to M. So the acceleration of mass M1 is. So similar question. Now instead of two bodies, they have given us three bodies, and also they have same masses. So if I can just imagine it as previous question, where the mass, if I can take these two as a one single system, because they both have same acceleration. So 2m and m. So it becomes a similar problem as we had done just before it. The coefficient of friction is given as mu, so we have to find the acceleration, downward acceleration. So just same thing. The tension will cause it to move here, so a acceleration here. Mg will be, friction will be backwards, which will be equal to mu into 2mg. So for this, net force will be equal to T minus 2 mu mg will be equal to ma. But remember, m is now 2m. Similarly for this thing, mg is downwards, T is upwards, acceleration is downwards, so mg is greater than. So mg minus T will be equal to ma. But this time, instead of dividing, I will add these two equations. Add. Because we don't need tension now. We want tensor to get out of this equation. So if we add this, you can see this T gets cancelled out, and you get net force as mg minus, which is generally called as driving force, minus 2 mu mg will be equal to 3 ma. M, m, m. And you get acceleration as g times 1 minus 2 mu by 3. The correct option in this case is C. Why cannot we say the rain is falling 30 degrees southeast? 30 degrees southeast. Why we can't say the rain is falling? Basically, north, south, east, west are in horizontal plane. Suppose we are living in a South Delhi. So South Delhi doesn't mean it is vertically downwards. South Delhi is horizontally towards South Pole. And the rain falls in vertical direction. So that's why when you say southeast, it means rain is going in a horizontal direction. So it is inappropriate to say that rain is falling 30 degree southeast. I hope this clears you. Okay. Question number 13 or 12. So it is a graph of force versus time, and we have to change the change in momentum. So change in momentum will be equal to the area under graph. Which graph? Force versus time graph. And remember, change in kinetic energy will be equal to area under force versus x graph. Basically work done. So remember two type of graphs, force versus time, force versus distance. Force versus distance graph will give you work done by the force, and force versus time will give you change in momentum, final momentum minus initial momentum. Yes, NCERT question was directly asked in your previous year exam. All these questions are previous year exams. If you have any books, you can just directly check. Every question is taken from previous year NEET. So this question, which was in your NCERT, came directly. So the area will be, but remember, this is positive, this is negative, and this is positive. I think you can do this. A1 minus A2 plus A3 will be equal to MV minus U, change in momentum. Okay, we can skip this. This is impulse. Because change in momentum is impulse. Hello Ankur sir, very good evening to you. Thank you for coming in my live session. We welcome you very much. And happy Diwali. So now Ankur sir is with you, you may ask even more doubts in your comments. So if you calculate, you will get the answer as option number. The answer is not given here. Do we have answer key? Thank you, sir. Thank you. Answer key. Where is the answer key? They have not ticked all the questions. So please, guys, wait for 2 minutes. Okay, so we got the answers now. The answer for 12th question is C option. Now let's go to question number 13. A balloon is descending down with an acceleration A. There is a balloon It is descending down with acceleration A. So the mass of balloon is given as M. So we know balloon, in balloon two forces act. One is the thrust force acting on its outer surface. You can see due to the air, the balloon has a very big volume, due to which the air surrounding it will apply a force in upward direction, which is called as thrust force of the air. And that will depend on the volume of the balloon, volume. So this is the thrust force of the air. Let me say this is S thrust. And of course, there are pupils sitting over here, which have water, weight or something. So due to which there will be downward force Mg. Now what is given to us in this case, the balloon is going downwards. Why is this happening? Because this weight, the weight of the balloon is greater than the thrust force. Acceleration is given to us. So we can write Mg minus thrust force will be equal to Ma. Suppose if we want to balloon to rise up, then we have to decrease this weight because this weight is making it down. So what we'll do, we'll throw some weight out of it. So due to which this Mg will reduce, although the thrust force won't change, because the size of balloon, we are not changing the size of balloon, we are just removing some weight out of it. So only Mg will change, this Mg will change, so thrust force will become dominating and it would have net acceleration in upward direction. So that weight is what we have to find. So if I remove some weight, let us say X weight is removed, then balloon starts accelerating upwards with same acceleration A. So this time the weight in the balloon will become M minus X. Weight has been reduced, thrust force will be greater, so the acceleration now will be upwards after removing the weight. So now if we write the net force, it will be F thrust minus M minus X times G will be equal to, be careful, here also you have to write only M minus X times A. Because only the remaining part is accelerating, not total. Just add these two. This F thrust gets cancelled out. You get GX is equal to 2MA minus XA. So from here you get acceleration as 2 or X as 2MA upon G plus 2MA upon G plus A, option number A. Scroll down. Question number 14. This question was also actually asked in your, I guess, SC Verma book. But this question came in your exam. It means they asked from some standard sources. Question number 14. The upper half of an inclined plane is perfectly smooth while the lower half is rough. Upper half is smooth, lower half is rough. Angle of inclination is same, theta. So when the block starts from here at rest, so initially the plane is smooth, so its speed will increase until unless this rough plane comes. At this point it would have maximum speed, but afterwards a friction force will start acting and the speed will decrease, and it is given to us when it reaches the bottom it again stops, final speed is zero due to friction force. So accelerated up to here and then deaccelerated and final speed becomes zero. So we have to find the coefficient of friction force, this mu. So it is given to us that both the planes have same length, the smooth one and the rough one. Let me take the length as L. So when it was accelerating downwards, we know the acceleration is only due to mg sin theta, no friction force, so acceleration would become simple g sin theta. So you can calculate this velocity as v square equal to u square plus 2as. So v max square minus 0 will be equal to 2. What is acceleration? G sin theta. And how much displacement? Let us say L, half of the length. First equation. Similarly, when it was going in rough vertical this inclined plane, there is acceleration in backward direction, which is caused due to friction force minus mg sin theta. Friction force must be greater. So in this case, the friction force is you can write the retardation over here as mu mg cos theta. It is the friction, but we have to subtract from this friction this mg sin theta term, and if you divide it by mass m, you get the retardation b, due to which the speed is decreasing. So if you apply the same equation, third equation, we know final speed is zero, initial speed is v max square. From here the initial speed for this point is v max. From here to here, initial is v max, final is zero in this plane. Will be equal to 2 times, acceleration will be negative because the speed is decreasing. So minus of this m gets cancelled out like this and this. So it is minus of mu cos theta minus mu cos theta minus sin theta times g into L. This is equation number 2. So just add these two equations, and or you could also divide these two equations, you get the same thing. So if you divide these two equations, you get minus 1 equals to 2 gets cancelled out, L gets cancelled out, and this minus 1 will be equal to g sin theta upon minus of mu cos theta minus sin theta times g. This g gets cancelled out with this like that. Minus minus becomes plus 1. So from here you get mu will be equal to 2 tan theta. Yes, option number B. So basically it is more like a motion in 1D kind of questions, where we are using acceleration, calculating acceleration using Newton's law. Question 14 is done. Question number 15. Three blocks are connected as shown. So these are the three blocks. M, 2M and 3M. and it is given that they are moving with constant speed. So when the speed is constant, dv by dt, which is acceleration, becomes zero. So constant speed means net acceleration should be zero. It means this force must be exactly cancelled out by total weight of the system. So what is total weight of the system? M plus 2m plus 3m. This is acting downwards as 3 plus 2, 5 plus 6, 6mg. It means the force is equal to 6mg. Acceleration is zero for everything. So if the acceleration is zero, the tension here would be equal to its weight, 3mg in both direction. Tension here would be equal to, but be careful, the tension here is not the weight of just 2m, but rather weight of both 3 and 2 together. So tension at here will be, T dash will be equal to 5mg in both the directions. So I would like to give you some surprise.
Pehle ko kya hai?
English session, sir.
How are you, students? Swagata Deep Sarkar.
Although they know Hindi.
Rashika Gulati.
But we
Mustafa
have to speak
Memon,
in English.
Nisha Yadav, how are you? Manzoor Khan. Are you enjoying your studies, guys? Are you enjoying your studies? You should never hate your studies. This is what is going to make you what you want to be in life. You want to be a doctor, that is why you are studying. You will achieve your dreams by doing this right now. So don't hate your studies. Try and absorb it. Try and understand it. You will start becoming comfortable in it. I'm good, Rashika. Sir, how are they doing?
They are doing well.
Very good. I'm waiting for you outside.
Sure. So acceleration is zero, of course. Our question was done in few seconds. Option number D. Yes, the psycat in lower half, it will travel with the same retardation. Yes, you are absolutely right. You can directly equate g sin theta as mu g cos theta minus g sin theta.
What is it?
Just equate A equal to B. Yes, sir.
I think you are hungry.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Wow, this is so delicious.
Now you'll have the energy to teach laws
thank
of
you. I think, hello, am I audible? Yes, now I am. Can you tell some tenorial identities which will come handy in solving questions? There are so many, my dear. We'll discuss them one by one, but today's our aim is to conclude this session. So yes, there are few trigonometric entities which come again and again, like 1 minus sin theta, 1 minus cos theta, 1 plus cos theta, and sin theta into cos theta. Half angles and double angles and sine A plus sine B. So these are few important trigonometric properties which come in again. But right now, first let's complete this session. There are 10 more questions remaining and I think we have only half an hour time. So question number 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. So we have 10 more questions remaining. Question number 16. An explosion breaks a rock into three parts in a horizontal plane. So, three part, 1, 2, and 3. Two of them goes right angle to each other. So let's say these are the two which moves at right angle to each other. The part, the first part of mass 1 kg, this is 1 kg, goes with the speed of 12 meter per second. Second part has mass 2 kg and it goes with the speed 8 meter per second. And we have to, if the third part flies off with 4 meter per second, then it's mass. Its velocity is given as 4 meter per second, but its mass is unknown. So before explosion, this was after explosion. So before, it was intact and placed at rest. So when the explosion takes place, it is due to the internal forces. So this is the best example where we see internal forces can increase the energy, can do the work, can change the kinetic energy, but they cannot change the momentum of the system. So internal forces may provide the energy to the system, but they cannot change the momentum. It means the momentum before the collision, explosion should be equal to the total momentum after the explosion. So applying conservation of momentum, because explosion, during explosion only internal forces act, initial momentum should be equal to just after the explosion final momentum. So initial momentum was zero. Let's write the final momentum. So because these two are in right angle, I can assume one of them as J cap and other as I cap. And this, let's say its velocity is V vector. So you get 0 equal to M1 into 12 J cap plus 8 into 2 I cap plus M into 4. So net should be 0, so from here you get M as, because M is a scalar, so you have to calculate the magnitude of minus 12 minus 16 by 4. This is 12 J cap, 16 I cap. So if you take the magnitude, it becomes mod of 3 J plus 4 I. So it becomes 5 kg. So very good example of conservation of momentum with vector, application of vector. 5 kg, option number A. What is the use of banking of road during surgery? Surgery of what? Surgery of what? Actually, your question is not clear to me. Banking of road with surgery. Question number 17. I guess this is also a similar question. Car of mass 1000 kg negotiates a bank curve of radius 90 meter on a frictionless road. It means mu is equal to 0. So if you can recall the formula, the V max was under root of GR times 1 plus mu k tan theta, mu k plus tan theta upon 1 minus mu k tan theta. It was like this. So if you put mu k as 0 over here, as 0 over here, you get this as under root of gr tan theta v max. So just put the values, you will get the answer 30. I think we can skip this question, just direct application of the formula. So question number 17 would have answer as D. Question number 18. The previous question was similar to the, yes, you are right, Saket, you are right. The resultant momentum of the both is the momentum of third body. Yes, resultant momentum of the remaining two will be equal to the third body. Of course, it has to be in magnitude and as well as in direction, both. Question number 18, we have the maximum speed of car in circular motion. So I have told you mv square by r is provided by in horizontal plane when there is no banking. Horizontal plane of motion, where there is no banking, the centripetal force is provided by friction force, which is mu mg, because there is no banking, so total normal reaction will be mg. So from here you get, m gets cancelled out, v as under root of mu g r, where r is the radius of the circle. Directly standard question. So question number 18, option number D again. Question number 19. A person of 60 kg inside a lift of mass 940 kg presses the button on control panel. This lift starts moving upward with acceleration 1 meter per second square. The tension in the supporting cable is. So this person is connected to the supporting cable. This is the lift, this is the cable, and cable is taking it upwards. Let's say the tension in cable is T. So lift has a how much mass? 940 kg. And the person is sitting over here also has mass 60 kg. And both of them are moving upwards with acceleration 1 meter per second square. So this cable is accelerating both the objects, lift as well as person. But it has to, we also have to consider the gravitational weight of both the persons, which is total is mg m1 plus m2 times g, which is 1000 into 10. So just apply the laws of motion, Newton's second law. Net force is upwards because acceleration upwards. So T will minus 10,000 will be equal to total mass into 1. So you get T as 11,000 Newton. Yes, option number again, D again. Yes, whole system. Question number 20. So this is a block of mass m, moves with velocity v, hits and bounced back with same velocity v. So impulse will be equal to, I think I don't have to do much thing over here. If you want to write, final momentum is mv minus initial momentum is mv. So some of you might get zero, but this is wrong because it is v vector also. We also have to consider direction. So if this is I cap, this becomes minus I cap. So when you put these values over here, you get V minus V I cap minus of V I cap. So it becomes minus 2M VI cap. So double 2 MV. Again option number D. Question number 21. A radioactive nucleus of mass M emits a photon. Photon of frequency mu. And due to which this will recoil. Again, same thing, conservation of momentum. So when a radioactive nuclei decays, it emits photons, or it may emit some particles. But we know for a system, total momentum has to be conserved. So if it ejects out something, it will get a recoil in backward direction, and both must have same momentum. So that is what we have to find, the recoil energy. It means the total energy of the block. So both would have same momentum, P, but in opposite direction. It is in left, it is in right. So the kinetic energy of this thing will become, let's first write the momentum, because momentum for photon is basically H by lambda, whereas lambda is its wavelength. But frequency is given to us. So we have to put frequency in terms of lambda. So we know frequency, lambda into frequency is speed of light. So from here we get lambda as C by mu. So if you replace it here, you get momentum of the photon as H by C times mu. This is the momentum. And this momentum, when we get the value of momentum as H nu by C, but we know for nucleus, it is kinetic energy, it is basically velocity, speed. So it becomes capital M into V. So this is momentum from photon, and this is momentum of nuclei, and both have to be equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. So from here we get momentum as H nu, or V speed as H nu by C. So the kinetic energy of, or the recoil kinetic energy, recoil kinetic energy of nuclei will be equal to half of capital M of this V square. So if you add them, it becomes half of capital M of H nu by C. Sorry, this is by not C, this is H nu by M, Cm, Cm whole square. So this is the recoil kinetic energy of the nuclei. Very good question. So correct answer will be C option. Very good question. So basically modern physics, they have taken the concept of momentum, and from Newton's law, they have taken the concept of conservation of momentum. These two were combined to give the concept of work energy theorem, which is kinetic energy. Very good question. Three concepts, three chapters, same question. Let's go to question number 22. There is a block M in contact with the car as shown in figure. The coefficient of static friction between car and block is mu. The acceleration alpha of the car that will prevent the block from falling satisfies. So basically here is the question. This is the car. It is accelerating in this direction as alpha. And there is a block on its front surface, mass M, and coefficient of friction mu. And this block does not fall down, but it has a tendency to fall down due to its weight. But we know this tendency, because this surface is rough, so it will slide down. So friction force is opposing it. but friction force needs some normal reaction. So normal reaction is provided by the car. So basically this becomes the free body diagram in ground frame. So in ground frame, which is our inertial frame, we don't have to add pseudo force. So if you see the block, this block, M block, has vertical force mg, upward force friction, and horizontal force normal. And of course, because it is with the wheel always, and wheel is accelerating, it means this block is also accelerating with the same acceleration. Everything with the wheel is accelerating, everything with the car will move with the same acceleration, because with respect to car it is in rest. So this block must have same acceleration alpha. So this is what we observe from ground. Now apply the laws of motion along horizontal and along vertical. In vertical direction we have to cancel. F should be equal to mg, and in horizontal direction n should be equal to m into alpha. And third thing, this friction force should be less than equal to mu n. If you combine these three things, we get mg should be less than equal to mu times n, n is m alpha, m gets cancelled out, so alpha should be greater than equal to g by mu. Third option. So this time I have solved this question without using pseudo force, because when we don't use pseudo force, then we have to solve it in the ground frame. It means we have to consider the acceleration of the block, which we were taking as zero in car frame. So it's the same thing. Question number 23. So what is question number 23? Same concept. Gramophone is basically a circular disc which is rotating. So you have some circular disc like this which is rotating with angular speed omega, and something is placed at a distance r, some coin is placed at a distance r from the center. So it will also rotate with the same angular velocity omega. It is moving in a circle. So we need some force which act towards the center, which is nothing but the friction force, to provide the centripetal acceleration. So friction force will be equal to mv square by r, but because omega is given as to us, so f is equal to m omega square r. But again the friction force is limiting one, so f should be less than equal to mu n, because it is in horizontal plane, so n is mg. So f is less than equal to mu times mg. So from here we get m omega square should be less than equal to mu mg. M gets cancelled out, you get omega less than equal to under root of mu g by r. We have to calculate omega or what? Sorry, we have to calculate radius. So r should be less than equal to mu g by omega square. Similar same concept. Yes, so option number C again. Question number 24. Thank you, Ronit. Thank you so much. I think some of concepts which we had discussed here have been basically made you say straight like this. I am very glad. And I hope that you all will learn these simple concepts which come in your exam. And this is how we can make physics as a scoring subject. We have to make physics as a scoring subject. And that is the aim of both of us, you and us. So keep coming to the sessions. Enjoy these sessions. If you have any doubts, ask the query. And utilize your time efficiently in just these 1 and 2 hours during the sessions. So question number 24 is, force vector is given to us as 6i minus 8j plus 10 kg, acceleration is given to us as 1 m/s². Mass, so Newton's law, we know F is equal to m into a. So if you take the magnitude, because mass is a scalar quantity, so it is 6i minus 8j plus 10 kg. Force is magnitude, will be equal to mass, and acceleration magnitude is given to us as 1. So mass is nothing but the magnitude of this thing, which I think is 6² + 8² + 10² √ 10√2 kg. Yes, C option. So last question of the session. Now, last question of the session, question number 25. There is a lift, again lift questions, similar questions come in your exam. Sometimes they ask lift, sometimes they just bang the road. 2000 kg, and the tension in the supporting cable, this is the supporting cable. In previous question they had asked the tension, but in this question they have given us the tension in the cable as 2800 newton. We have to find the acceleration. So sometimes what people may do is just divide this force upon mass, because they don't realize that mg is also acting. So just don't jump into the question without realizing what they are asking. You have to find the acceleration. Of course it will move upwards, but this is a lift, this is not in free space. There will be weight of the lift which will be downwards mg. So to write the acceleration, you have to write T minus mg equal to ma. If you don't write mg, then of course you will get the wrong answer. So this was the hidden thing in the question. Now put the values, 28,000 minus mg is 2000 into 10 will be equal to 2000 into a. So 8000 by 2000 will be equal to a. So 4 m/s² upwards. So this is how we complete the session. So this time, in previous session the paper was little bit on tough side, and I have told you sometimes we give easy questions, sometimes we give tricky questions, sometimes we give tough questions, sometimes we give you calculative questions, and this time we have given you previous year questions directly. So that basically you would know what actual comes in your exam. All these questions in this session were, all these questions, each and every were taken from your NEET previous year papers, from past, I guess, 5 year questions, 5 or 6, 7 years questions. So I think this is very, very helpful to you, and keep studying. And if you have any queries, any doubt, just feel free to ask us, because that also helps us to know what is going on with the students. We are teachers, we know it from one point of view, but we need your point of view to know what exactly troubling you, what is causing you to basically get low mark or low scores, because everyone can get a good score. It is not very difficult. Human mind is very powerful to understand very complex things. So it's not like that you are weak or so. No one is weak. Just sometimes you may not understand what is the meaning or what is the sense it is making. So please do share with us your problems, whatever you have, and keep on doing like this, and you will become doctor someday. Thank you.